Solstice and Christmas through the ages. Timeline, symbols, traditions, and characters. The origins of Christmas begin with no less than the origins of religion, topped off with the spread of Roman power over Europe. We begin with solstice when the night is at its longest and the daylight hours begin to creep back up. It may have started as early as the first farmers. The word Yule came from Aboriginal Scandinavians and it means solstice, which means stopped sun. Early Julian calendar Yule was on December 25th. Changes since place it around the 21st. Take note, Romans didn't reach Scandinavia and Northern Europe until sometime between 900 and 1000. 2750 BCE. Old Celt temple in Ireland called Newgrange, carbon dated back to 2750, seems to be the oldest existing calendar which detects the solstice. 2000 BCE. Ancient Egypt celebrated solstice with a 12-day festival, used greenery to decorate, decorated palm trees. Ancient Babylon, the feast of the son of Isis, goddess of nature, was celebrated on December 25th. Raucous partying, gluttonous eating and drinking, and gift-giving were traditions of this feast. Persians celebrated Sisaya with masquerades and misrule. Mithra was acknowledged savior, claimed to be the celebration of the birth of Horus. The god-man-savior Osiris died and was entombed on December 21st. At midnight, the priests emerged from an inner shrine crying, "The Virgin has brought forth, the light is waxing," and showing the image of a baby to the worshippers.
Hello again, and welcome you all to Hell for another Mondo Diablo Atheist Christmas podcast. This time, we here show you a perspective on the timeline of the Christmas history. We hope you have taken the notes and have them with you for reference. There will be a test.
Stacking baking, cooking and a baking for the children everywhere. While the corns are popping, you're skipping and a hopping, lollipop in your hand. Happy feet are tapping, clicking and a clacking to the spoon and kettle band. While the candy dandy elves pile the candy on the shelves, singing Peppy the peppermint. Peppermint, Peppy the peppermint.
630 to 580 BCE. Jeremiah 10, 2 through 4. Thus saith the Lord, learn not the way of the heathen, and be not dismayed at the signs of heaven, for the heathen are dismayed at them. For the customs of the people are vain, for one cutteth a tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of the workmen with the axe. They deck it with silver and with gold, they fasten it with nails and with hammers, that it move not. From the KJV. Ancient Greece. The winter solstice ritual was called Linnea, the festival of the wild women. In very ancient times, a man representing the harvest god Dionysus was torn to pieces and eaten by a gang of women on this day. Later in the ritual, Dionysus would be reborn as a baby. By classical times, the human sacrifice had been replaced by the killing of a goat. The women's role had changed to that of funeral mourners and observers of the birth. Greeks feared demon creatures during dark days and used a log, even after they became Christian. 50 BCE, Ancient Rome. Saturnalia was December 17th through 23rd. Misrule. Master and servant roles reversed. Societal, sexual rules suspended. Even children ruled their parents. Decorated homes with greenery. Decorated trees with bits of metal and Bacchus ornaments. Celebration for Saturn, December 17th, and Ops, December 19th, combined to make it a week's celebration. Beginning of costumed mummers.
Once you pass these borders, you can never return again. village in a pear tree.
On the second day of Christmas, my true love said to me, two turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the third day of Christmas, my true love said to me, three French hens,
two turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree. On the fourth day of Christmas, my true love said to me, four calling birds,
three French hens,
two turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the fifth day of Christmas, my true love said to me, five gold rings,
four calling birds,
three French hens,
two turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree. On the sixth day of Christmas, my true love said to me, six geese a lay,
five gold rings,
four calling birds,
three French hens,
two turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the seventh day of Christmas, my true love sent to me, seven swans a swimming,
six geese a laying,
five gold rings,
four calling birds,
three French hens,
two turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree. On the eighth day of Christmas, my true love sent to me, eight maids a milking,
seven swans a swimming,
six geese a laying,
five gold rings.
And then he sent me four calling birds,
three French hens,
two turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the ninth day of Christmas, my true love sent to me, nine ladies dancing,
eight maids a milking,
seven swans a swimming,
six geese a laying,
five gold rings.
A bean and or pea was placed in a fruit cake, and whoever finds it is king or queen. If a guy gets the pea, he chooses the queen. 160 to 230. Tertullian, an early Christian leader and prolific writer, complained that too many fellow Christians had copied the pagan practice of adorning their houses with lamps and with wreaths of laurel at Christmas time. 200s. Celtic druids celebrated solstice as a death rebirth, sun god festival with ritual. 275. Romans incorporated many peoples with many religions that associated birth to the time, including Egypt. Aurelian blended these to be the December 25th birth of the unconquered sun, S-U-N, and Mithraism was declared the official religion of Rome. 350. early Roman Catholic Church. Pope Julius I declared Christ's birth to be December 25th, right in the middle of Saturnalia, turning pagan festivities into Christian ones. Many sources cite the reason as to co-opt the pagan festivals, thus causing celebrants to be unwittingly honoring Christ. There is little doubt that he was trying to make it as painless as possible for pagan Romans, who remained a majority at that time, to convert to Christianity. The new religion went down a bit easier, knowing that their feasts would not be taken away from them. 375. Eastern Christian churches begin observing Christ's birth.
Delivering some toys to a great big family, and I heard a strange little sound like someone playing a flute, and I heard still another sound like a little toy trombone toot.
Oh, the little toy doll was playing the flute, and the little toy soldier the drum. All we could hear was a rudy toot toot and dum dee dee dum dum dum. Oh, the little toy train came over the hill, and the mama doll started to hum. And the little toy flute gave a tiny trill, and the soldiers marched to the drum. Truck was blowing his horn, and the little toy ship blew too, and the little toy farmer danced in the corn, and the flute played little boy blue.
Now lend your ears to old Saint Nick, and I'll tell you what you should do. Just play this record on the other side, and I'll finish my tale for you. Now this was something I couldn't believe, and I shook my head as I gazed. I wiped my eyes on the fur of my sleeve, for I was truly amazed. It was time to go up the chimney again and deliver the rest of my... I heard the sound again, that wonderful, strange little noise.
every Christmas morning just before five, the toys have fun on their own. And just for a moment they come alive if they're sure that they're alone. And the little toy dolls play little toy flutes and little toy soldiers their drums. And under the tree you hear Rudy toot toot and dum-dee-dee-dum-dee-dum. Dolls dance with skill, and the little toy truck goes honk, 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 and they all play together until
it's Christmas!
And then they became just toys again, and our magical story ends. A Merry Christmas to one and all from your lion material friends.
In the 300s, St. Nicholas, the Bishop of Myra, became a saint, patron saint of bankers, pawnbrokers, scholars, pirates, butchers, sailors, thieves, haberdashers, orphans, children, kings, and New York City. Essentially, the patron saint of capitalism in the industrial age, was known to be wealthy from inheritance, known for giving it away, credited with many miracles, of course, as a saint. Said to have reassembled the bodies of murdered students and brought them back to life. Ho, ho, ho! Saint's Death Day, December 6th, where European children get their presents. Said to have been tortured for opinions on scripture, hotly disputed. In the 400s, Irish Church begin observing Christ's birth. 567, Council of Troyes, 12 days of Christmas declared officially sacred. Belief in spirits, demons, devils roaming the earth specifically during this time. Many cite the reasons for spirits as being hostility by the evil things towards celebrating Christ's birth. 600s. Church in Jerusalem started celebrating Jesus' birth. By celebrate, I mean observe in a Christian church-like way. 700s. Church in Austria, England, and Switzerland recognizes Jesus' birth. 800s and 900s, Slavic churches recognize Christ's birth. Vikings brought St. Nicholas myths back to Scandinavia. 1170, German word for Christmas, Weihnachten, Holy Night, emerges. 1300s, earliest known in-home Christmas trees were known as Paradise Baum in Germany to celebrate the feast of Adam and Eve, December 24th.
Thank you.
1400s. Polydore Virgil, a 15th century British Christian, said, "Dancing, masks, mummeries, stage plays, and other such Christmas disorders now in use with Christians were derived from these Roman Saturnalian and Bacchanalian festivals, which had caused all pious Christians eternally to abominate them." 1458. Anonymous Christmas Carol welcomes Sire Christmas. Richard Smert's 1400s carol also welcomes Father Christmas, a purely secular spirit of Christmas. 1500s. Protestants, England, understandably tried to replace St. Nicholas as gift-bringer. Christchild, Christkind, Christkindle, Father Christmas, Weihnachtsmann. Protestants credited with moving gifts to December 25th, or New Year's. Children expected presents in their shoes still on the 6th in Northern Europe. John Calvin objects to observing Christmas and Easter, citing pagan roots and secular frivolity. In 1551, he recommends a quiet observance of Jesus' birth, and it seems people thought he objected to that altogether. He suggested that the shops be closed in the mornings and opened later in the day so people could go to church. The first documented Christmas controversy was Christian-led and began during the English Interregnum, when England was ruled by a Puritan parliament. Puritans, including those who fled to America, sought to remove elements they viewed as pagan because they were not biblical in origin from Christianity. During this period, the English Parliament banned the celebration of Christmas entirely, replacing it with a day of fasting and considering it a popish festival with no biblical justification and a time of wasteful and immoral behavior. The army were sent to raid homes and confiscate any cooked meat. This led to such resentment that it provoked riots in Kent, leading to the Second Civil War and the Siege of Colchester.
What are you doing here?
Well, Albert, I've got a problem.
Oh, how's that, Santa?
Well, I'm afraid I won't be able to complete my rounds this year. I need some help.
Oh, hey, Santa, you came to the right guy. You know, you can always count on me.
Albert, you're a real friend. I'll see you Christmas Eve.
Guess who's helping Santa Claus this year on Christmas Eve? I was quite amazed and my pals all gazed when Santa came to me. I wondered what his reason was for asking me this year. There are so many trees, won't you, Albert, please? And I answered with this cheer. Oh, yes, Santa, I'll help you make the rounds. Because I love the boys and girls, and I know the town. So I'm helping Santa Claus this year on Christmas Eve.
Hey, Al, how about me? I can help.
Lucky Santa asked me.
Yeah, I know, but it looks like you're going to have your hands through the floor. And I can sing good, too. Listen. I could help old Santa Claus this year on Christmas Eve. Al, you're kind of small, being pals and all, and my services are free.
All right, this operation needs is a woman's help.
Please, Alice, we got enough help.
Enough help? Enough help? Did I hear you say enough help? In this era of women's lib, you men never have enough help. You remember that? Pay attention. I could help old Santa Claus. You need a woman's touch. Though I am petite and very sweet, I want to help so much.
Oh, yes, Santa, we'll help you make the rounds. Because we love the boys and girls, and we know the town.
So we're helping Santa Claus this year on Christmas Eve. If you love Mom and Dad and you haven't been bad, there'll be gifts from Santa and me.
'1600s Massachusetts. Puritans banned Christmas for the celebration with pagan rites. 1604, Strasbourg. On Christmas, they put fir trees in rooms in Strasbourg. They hang red roses cut from many-colored paper, apples, offerings, gold tinsel, sugar. It is the custom to make a four-cornered frame around it. 1616, Father Christmas, the spirit of Christmas specifically cited as a merry old man, is first observed during English Reformation as a protest to the Puritan criticism of the celebration of Christmas festival. The earliest such was that in Ben Jonson's creation in Christmas, His Mask, dating from December 1616, in which Christmas appears attired in round hose, long stockings, a closed doublet, a high-crowned hat with a brooch, and a long, thin beard, a truncheon, little ruffles, white shoes, his scarves and garters tied across, and announces, "Why, gentlemen, do you know what you do? Ha! Would you have kept me out? Christmas, old Christmas?" Later, in A Mask by Thomas Nabbs, the spring's glory, produced in 1638, Christmas appears as an old reverend gentleman in furred gown and cap. 1647, English Parliament abolishes Christmas. Oliver Cromwell preached against the heathen traditions. 1652, a book dating from the time of the Commonwealth, The Vindication of Christmas, or His 12 Years' Observations Upon the Times, London, 1652, involved Old Christmas, advocating a merry, alcoholic Christmas and casting aspersions on the charitable motives of the ruling Puritans.
Oh, hanging on the windowsill was a little Christmas stocking with a hole in the toe. And when Santa came to call at the house upon the hill, he saw the Christmas stocking hanging in the candle glow.
Santa chuckled to himself as he walked across the floor to the little Christmas stocking with the hole in the toe. And he saw a note was pinned to the place where it was tore. He read the note, then turned his head so teardrops would not show.
The note said, "Santa, I am just a little boy, and I have everything that could bring me Yuletide joy. When you fill my stocking, if it should overflow, I won't mind if something pushes through the hole in the toe."
Santa went back to his sled and he loaded up his sack. Then he went back down the chimney and his heart was oh so glad. And he filled the stocking until no more he could pack, 'cause the note said, "Please, dear Santa, could you make the gifts for Mom and Dad?"
The note said, "Santa, I am just a little boy, and I have everything that could bring me Yuletide joy. When you fill my stocking, if it should overflow, I won't mind if something pushes through the hole in the toe."
Santa went back to his sled and he loaded up his sack. Then he went back down the chimney and his heart was oh so glad.
And he filled the stock,
'cause the note said, "Please, dear Santa, could you make the gifts for Mom and Dad?"
$16.59, Christmas celebrating illegal in Massachusetts. Fine, 5 shillings. $16.60, the restoration of the monarchy in England under Charles II brought back official recognition of Christmas in England, but not in the U.S. 1679, the Salem Wassail fiasco. 1681, fine for Christmas celebrating dropped in New England, but it still wasn't an official public holiday. 1686, Josiah King's The Examination and Trial of Old Father Christmas, together with his clearing by the jury. 1700s, Germans immigrate to New World, bringing Christmas tree tradition with them. 1749, Boston Freemasons have a large Christmas feast and parade on the 27th. A collection of prosperous businessmen, of course. Boston had a large population of Freemasons. The parade was semi-private, as the aproned throng sort of pressed in towards the parade to keep others out. The Masons started at a tavern, went to a church service, and marched back to the tavern. 1760s to 1790s. The Antics, groups of aggressive Christmas mummers, would go from house to house putting on plays and expect, of course, to be paid in wine and food. They were a sort of guerrilla theater in that they wore masks, much like the traditional Commedia dell'arte. But these weren't the Grimaldis. They were often not well received, and the moneyed felt put upon to provide for smelly street people. They were rough and used rough language. The genteel felt they were under a social contract to oblige them, but they complained nonetheless. This was the misrule that the religious felt they were up against. Other aggressive mumming demonstrations persisted in New York and London.
Thank you.
1800. Unitarians and Universalists begin calling for a public celebration of Christmas again as a religious church observance. As conservatives, but theologically liberal, they acknowledged that Christmas was not biblically sanctioned, but they just wanted it. The campaign was not a great success, but they couldn't get many shops to shut on Christmas, and only five Reformed churches held service the first and second year of the Crusade. Many publications were behind the Crusade, but its momentum ran out in 1819. The services were left to the Papists. 1804. John Pintard, prominent merchant and civic leader, founder of New York Historical Society, proclaimed St. Nicholas patron saint of New York. 1809. Washington Irving, New York Historical Society Knickerbocker writer, wrote Knickerbocker's History of New York, published on December 6th. Knickerbocker was a New York magazine and also a group of writers, including Clement Clark Moore, who are sort of the princes of Battery Park and Wall Street, eventually. In the book, St. Nicholas is described as an elfin Dutch burgher with a clay pipe. Washington Irving suggested that St. Nicholas comes down chimneys, like Thor. Knickerbockers and others described as wanting to castrate slash tame slash domesticate Christmas from drunken street party to a stay-at-home time. People started noticing children for the first time due to the emerging middle class and a new industrial economy. And what they noticed was that children need discipline. Boys. The upper classes were threatened. Why not put them indoors with parents where they could be nurtured and leave us alone? And if we can make money on it, all the better. A good way to buy stuff.
Thank you.
first thought that toys could be an enticement to good behavior and a threat of bad, look at the postcards. Christmas misrule comes to a head as a social threat. 1821, The Children's Friend, an anonymous book, was published and had Santa Claus with one flying reindeer. He arrives on December 24th instead of December 6th. First reference to reindeer. 1823, Clement Seymour, a Knickerbocker poem, A Visit from St. Nicholas, is published with a little protest from the serious Moore. Moore describes Santa with an inspiration from Irving. He wore fur, had a white beard, was fat, smoked a pipe, was an elf, was jolly. 1835, founding of the St. Nicholas Society. 1843, A Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens is published. 1851, Pastor Henry Schwann of Cleveland, Ohio, appears to have been the person responsible for decorating the first Christmas tree in an American church. His parishioners condemned the idea as a pagan practice. Some even threatened the pastor with harm, but objections soon dissipated. Christmas trees were popularized in homes in the U.S. by then, by Prince Albert. Franklin Pierce brought Christmas trees into the White House in the 1850s. 1856, Christmas is finally made a legal holiday in Massachusetts. 1863, Thomas Nast's drawings in Harper Magazine in December heavily influenced what Santa looked like. Two or three historians said that Thomas Nast's Santa, looking nothing like St. Nicholas, were images from his youth of not St. Nicholas, but a Belschnickel, or Fur Nicholas, who, by the time of his youth, were performing all the duties of Santa Claus, including going down the chimney, giving gifts and switches. Santa was politicized immediately, like Superman, as supporting the North in the Civil War.
This is Santa's big scene, and above all the bustle you hear.
Silver bells, silver bells, it's Christmas time in the city. Ring-a-ling. Hear them ring, soon it will be Christmas Day, soon it will be Christmas Day.
1890. By the time Christmas was official in the U.S. and England, lots of hostility brewed. It became a joke to tip your chamber pot into these pre-carolers. First Department Store Santa by James Edgar in Brockton, Massachusetts in 1890. 1897, September 21st, Yes, Virginia, There is a Santa Claus was published in the New York Sun. 1915 was the first Eaton's Santa Claus Parade in Toronto. In 1922, Norman Rockwell's Pictures of Santa in the Saturday Evening Post seals the deal on Santa's appearance. In 1923, Calvin Coolidge has the first National Christmas Tree Lighting Ceremony. And finally, in 1931, the first Santa Claus Coke ad. This spurs the urban legend that Coca-Cola invented Santa Claus.
Ah, yes. Alison has been very hard at work. If you visit the blog at mondodiablo.blogspot.com, you can see her and how serious she is as she records this very text. We hope you will come back often and see the blog and listen for the Christmas countdown with J.R. Bob Dobbs every day in December. Please to enjoy your winter fun.